Hey everybody, it's Red Hook doing our stream. I'm Chris.
We're hooking it up. Sorry. This is Tyler.
This is Keir.
This is Brooks.
This is Keir.
All right, so today is a special stream because it's going to be our last one of the year, I think. We're crunching like crazy to get early access ready to go, so I think we're going to call it so that we can work on secret stuff and roll things out in the new year. But because of that, we thought it'd be cool to work on something a little bit different. We have to add a shot to the House of Ruin trailer to make it work for the game intro, and so I'm doing that today. Let's see here. Blah.
Oh, jeez.
So yeah, this is kind of where I'm taking this. There's going to be people running away from it. Basically, this is what your ancestor sees when he digs into the cave, and it's really awful. You probably won't get as good a look at it in the actual trailer. When we're finished with it, it will light it a little bit and make it kind of hard to see and bring it in and out. So you guys get the bonus of being able to properly appreciate the disgustingness of the worst thing in the world.
I think we should make this a wallpaper.
Yeah, we could. Totally. So gotta draw the little background bits there. Yeah, so I had some rough colors in there, and I was just cleaning up lines and adding more mouths and eyes. So, just get rid of these colors, and, yeah.
Does the creature have a name?
Jeez. No. You can't name it. You can't even know it and maintain control of your faculties.
It's the unnameable.
Yeah.
That's the name, which that logic itself will just bring the entire universe to a halt.
Yeah, so this is not the final boss. We're not spoiling anything for the game. This is just kind of something awful from down there that they found. But in no way should you infer that this is a playable class, for instance.
It looks a little bit bigger than four slots.
Yeah, especially... Yeah, I have the little tiny guys in there. Where are they here? For scale, like, they'll be like... These are like stalactites and... Dudes will be like, yeah.
I like your fast falling over poses.
Yeah, they're this one especially is really good. Looks totally like a person. Okay, where was I? So yeah, what have you guys been up to?
Oh, us.
Yeah.
Tyler's been up to a lot since we last streamed.
Yeah. Well, yes, I have. Oh, you mean physically?
Yeah, physically, emotionally. Yeah.
I semi-wrecked my knee, but it turns out it's fortunately not as wrecked as I feared.
The game is fine.
Yeah. I mean, that was, I think, the first thing is I was like, Chris, I totally wrecked my knee. And he's just like, oh, the things that we have to overcome to get this game done. And, hobbling into work on...
I was actually happy about it because I felt like you'd be... The longer you're confined to a chair, the more work you would get done.
Yeah, it does cut down on my ability to get out to the gym or just, you know, play sports and things like that that add balance to my life. It's not a time for balance right now. That's for sure.
I had that exact conversation.
It's definitely not time for balance.
Yeah, that's very true.
I had that conversation with my wife last night, actually.
Oh yeah.
Balance time is over.
We're working our tails off, and like Chris said about the stream, we don't want to show some of the stuff we're doing yet, and I think we'll resume streams because we do really enjoy it. And,
yeah.
And it's cool, and we just kind of like. We've got, it's like those scenes in the movies right now. You've got one mission, you know, and our mission is to get this game to early access and make it awesome. And so we're just
That's why I broke Tyler's leg, and that's why we're not streaming.
Yeah, yeah, that's why I got kneecapped.
It was surprisingly affordable. I'm going to put it in our backer update because we used Kickstarter money to break your legs.
Yeah, and it's a win for everyone because I didn't have to pay that much to get it healed since we have socialized healthcare up here. So it's a victimless crime, except for my knee.
Zedadol wants to know, what is the sports you speak of?
Frisbee.
Yeah, oh, sports ball.
Well, ultimate Frisbee.
Ultimate Frisbee.
Ultimate, yeah. Frisbee.
It wasn't just tossing with Chad in the field or something.
No. No, it's like, yeah, I've been playing that for a couple of years, and I love it in the winter up here because it's one of the only sports you can do just, well, I mean, obviously like hockey or something like that, but it's like you go play it in the turf field no matter if it's raining or snowing or sideways wind, or you show up and you play. And so I like being able to count on something as opposed to like stuff that you can only do during the sun, or also known as the July 1st to
July 7th.
Yeah, September 15th phase in Vancouver.
We got a question if the funding is closed already. Somebody new to the stream.
Yes, it is. We've actually closed our pre-orders in anticipation of early access. We had a couple of the more high-end tiers kicking around there on the site for a couple of months around PAX, but we've taken those down now. So you'll be able to buy the game when it goes live on Steam for early access, though.
Yep. Yeah, there will be no shortage of opportunities to buy it. It's just we kind of wanted to trail off that and just make it simpler to send everything through Steam once we launch. Or everything for, you know, except for like once we eventually offer the art books and stuff like that, you know, we'll probably offer some of those things a la carte eventually, but yeah.
Depression Core wants to know, what month is early access again? I will buy it day one. Then he winks. So I don't know if you can talk.
What does the wink mean?
He's probably already got it.
Ah,
that's what the wink probably means.
Or he knows the answer.
Yeah.
Real Bucks thinks it's February.
Yeah, that's what we said in the backer update. We've been working as hard as we can to see what we can do with that, but we'll have more news on it, I guess, in our next backer update, how we're progressing kind of overall. But February is a safe bet at this point, for sure.
You'll be able to play it on Valentine's Day.
Yeah, get it for your Valentine.
That's right.
Got you this pre-order.
Should make a Valentine's Day card out of this monster.
Yeah, I should.
We did a Valentine's Day card last Valentine's Day.
Yeah. No, last Valentine's Day we didn't we?
No.
Yeah, we did. Yeah, we did. The House of Cards.
He did the screenshot with the Vestal and the Crusader saying,
"Yeah,
want to watch House of Cards or whatever it was."
Oh yeah. Right, man.
There's a Valentine's Day card.
Yeah, just be mine.
Yeah. I choose you.
Yeah, so Chris, did you say we're going to do another backer update soon? And
yeah.
If there's any changes, we'll let you know. We're still figuring. Oh, God, the big man. That's good.
Yeah, we got a... We have a sample of the Pigman audio up on our website now from Power Up Audio. It sounds pretty awesome, and that level is really scary to walk around in. The ambient stuff they did in the Warrens is really cool. It totally feels like the darker it gets, the more pig guys are actually like running around hunting you. It's totally all just in the audio. It's really cool.
We got a question: if this is a boss or is it for promotion?
It's for promotion. It's part of the trailer. It's not going to, like, this isn't literally going to be the end boss. You can look forward to this type of creature in the game for sure. but it's not going to be like this dude. Exactly.
Basically, if you see this dude in the game, it's over already.
Yeah.
It's the end.
That's how you beat the game, is you don't beat the game. You just see this, mm-hmm. and it deletes your hard drive.
He's got mouths. He's got mouths for everyone. Enough mouths to go around. Yeah, we're all quiet today. I think we're just...
Facts on the back?
We're, I don't know. We're all stunned into our respective workloads, I guess.
Yeah. What? I don't think we're quiet. I mean, we just didn't talk for 5 seconds.
That felt like an uncomfortable silence.
Yeah, it's pretty weird. I'm kind of, like, completely zoned out lately. Just so much work to do, and I'm enjoying doing it, but just I'm completely enmeshed in it. It's hard to actually have a conversation. I had to go to a dinner party the other weekend, and I just didn't know what to say to anybody. Usually I don't have that problem, but I just kind of sat there like a tool.
But at least you could eat to hide your...
Yeah, just shove your face full of food.
The thing is, because I'm not normally socially awkward, feeling completely disempowered in a social setting, I had no coping skills. So I didn't have like a lifetime of awkwardness to draw on. Because I didn't know what to do. I was like, what is this? What's happening to me? Nothing I say is funny. And so I just drank a bunch of wine and went home.
Yeah, if you're telling
that sounds like my entire high school experience.
But yeah, the whole time I'm like
uncomfortable silences eventually turn into comfortable silences when you get to know the people better.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm more thinking
we're not getting married, Brooks. Jesus.
Is your uncomfortable silences minute?
Know we started as friends, but lay off.
Yeah. Now you're making it uncomfortable.
I'm getting more comfortable.
It actually wasn't so much the discomfort amongst, like, being quiet amongst ourselves. It was the idea that these people have come here for this hour to be entertained, and if we just sit there quietly, then it's really just a poor showing.
Hey, we can play some some pig music.
Oh yeah,
play some pig music.
How are you gonna do that?
Oh God, don't browse the
home. Oh yep, here we go. Uh-oh. Somebody doesn't
care.
Here
we go. Remember what happened last time.
Yeah. Yeah, it's fine. That's why we're here. To interlude this hot pig jam. Who's done by Tyler?
I don't think it's cool, so I don't want to give
someone
credit for silence.
So if you're a radio DJ, you let the song hit, and then tell them what they're listening to?
Well, yeah, they talk over all the time in the intros and outros.
Brooks did that.
What's that?
Rookies. Rooks.
Anyway.
It didn't play.
Depression Core has a very scared face and then follows it with this question. So each dungeon has its own battle theme?
Yeah, it does.
Yes. Sneaky Pie Brown with the follow-up question that's exactly the same. Do we have titles for the songs?
There will be titles.
I guess. Will there? Is Stuart naming them?
I believe he will. He's a pretty...
I hope he does.
He knows.
Yeah, me too.
Business backwards and forwards.
Lore question for Chris. Do you think each of these mouths have a separate digestive tract?
They do. No, it's always in a state of flux, right? Like, it's just growing and changing all the time, so if there's a mouth there now, it might be gone in a half a second. I don't know. I don't know how the insides of these things
and
work.
And then follow-up question from Keir. Does he have as many butts, or does it have as many butts as it does mouths?
Just one central anus.
That
funnels, you know, everything through it, yeah. It's a good question, though. Thanks.
So they imply one set of intestines and stomach. They all lead to the same place.
How do they... Oh, right. Yeah, I do feel like they share... they share a digestive system, just because, I mean, the goal is of having all the mouths is not so you have more mouths to feed. It's that sort of more effective. Like, I really think it's so you're more effective at acquiring food.
Yeah, you want to run it all through the central bank. You don't want to.
Yeah.
Yeah, like you could. It don't matter which side you're eating from. You're eating. That's what matters, right?
Craig, the intern with the hashtag of the day. Sign in.
What's the hashtag of the day?
What was the hashtag of the day?
The mouths are also the anuses.
Ouch.
Because it's me, the backer class.
How are you feeling, Tyler? Tyler, knee update.
Hold on. Oh, knee. Okay, I'm going to do. But first, I'm going to. This is our composer, Lynn. Sorry, my keyboard's loud.
What are you doing? Just
he's,
real quick.
He's typing it in because he can't. It's going.
Yeah. I hate when websites, they tell you you're logged in, but you're not. Anyway, the knee feels good. I have a broken bone, but that will heal. And no ligament damage, and I'm allowed to start trying to walk on it. So, yeehaw. Sorry, the broken bone is in the leg, not the knee, but whatever. We're splitting hairs.
Splitting ligaments.
Hey-oh.
And that was me at the dinner party.
Yeah, hey, he's back.
Yeah.
He's back.
What's the deal with ligaments?
Stress, so we can just keep joking back and forth. Crow wants to know what we're working on. Is something to do with the intro to the game.
Yeah, this is like a replace, or like an additional shot for the House of Ruin trailer, so that it can become part of the intro to the game. We're trying to get some other cinematic stuff in there as well, but we're gonna reuse that trailer because it sets up the fiction nicely, and so we just want to get rid of the old gameplay out of it and replace it with something more cinematic that'll take you straight into playing.
Yeah,
because especially now it's hard to look at that old footage. That was like the first footage we ever recorded. The game looks so much better now.
Yeah, I wonder. I never really noticed that with other games' trailers. Like, I wonder if you go back like 5 years, if it looks completely different.
Well, I'm sure it would. Otherwise, the game would have been done 5 years ago, right? No, my.
I mean, so Tyler posted an Instagram of Stuart Chatwood.
The Chatwood. Well, you got to look not just at Stuart Chatwood, but look beyond him to the building, and for an extra special bonus credit, find the second Stuart Chatwood.
Also.
So, yes, that's the it's pretty cool.
Noxus D wants to know how long until early access.
First part of 2015. Last time we said February. What is so funny?
Oh, it's just any part. It could be the first part.
I mean, like, the last we've said is February, and we're waiting to update that in the next backer update. It's not going to go later than that, so let's just say that.
It's like, oh, fuck.
First part of 2015, if it comes during or before February.
Because we don't want to say something offhand and then not do
it. At PAX, I took your guys's can't commit to a date completely seriously, so... Everybody I talked to at PAX, it was like 2015, and I'm like, can't commit to a date. 2016, yeah. Can't commit, man.
No. Okay, I said, that's not what I said.
You're allowed to say 2015.
Yes, it's going to be 2015. This is not vaporware. Like, when you say like June 6th, you know, and then it moves, it's more stress than everyone needs. If you say middle 2015, and then as you get closer, you confirm the exact date, then everybody's happy, including us. So, like, I mean, we've, in the grand scheme of things, our been rather fairly accurate, I think, compared to me.
Oh yeah, no, no, no. Yeah, no, we've been accurate.
So this is because I told Keir don't give an exact date. So I guess you didn't even want to lock down the year.
I specifically said, could I say 2015? And you were like, no, don't want to. But that's fine. It's over.
We've committed to February, and it won't be later than that. In other news, we're working as hard as we can.
Well, not right now.
Well, I am.
Well, you are.
I consider this as hard as I ever were.
Kier's going to take a day off and get sick after this.
Chaos Bagel asks, so how much do you guys plan on developing past the final release? Do you think you'll continue with later updates and content?
Kind of depends on how much we sell, to be honest.
Also depends what final release is, because arguably the final release wouldn't happen until we stopped working on it.
Okay, well, without being metaphysical, like, we could ship the 1.0 and then continue to develop the game and add to it. If there's an audience, right? Like,
Oh yeah.
If we don't sell, then
yeah. I mean, the plan is early access. We work on stuff, you know, up to where we've achieved what, you know, is the vision of the complete game, not like everything possible it could ever be in the game, but the vision of the complete game. Then we'd love to support it with DLC, and whether that DLC is a mix of free or paid, you know, we haven't figured out yet. And there's lots of scenarios where we could do either or both, things like that. But you know, we would love to keep supporting the game and rolling out content and doing things and all that kind of stuff. So it's just the convenience of kind of calling something the final release is like, okay, look, it stands alone, you know, as a complete game. So
are his eyes gonna glow?
No.
Or
I think that looks kind of cheesy. I actually tried it, but it feels like suddenly it's like every monster in the world.
Fair enough.
I'll show you.
What about if his eyes were the darkest things in the scene?
Yeah, I'd be more inclined to try that.
I just don't know where I would shoot it if it didn't have glowing eyes.
Well, yeah, I understand. I played that Frozen Planet. Well, yeah, that video game.
Now they just look like pimples.
Yeah. I don't know.
Whoa.
But I do like the extra dash of color.
You could just tint the eyes based on the holiday you're making a card for.
He's like got red and green eyes
and an orange and brown for Thanksgiving and green for St. Patrick's Day.
It's like
that'd be a good Easter egg to throw into the trailer on Christmas week. Miss after we release.
Okay.
Do you guys see that Batman game still has like holiday Easter eggs coming out?
Arkham, yeah. The original Arkham one?
Arkham City.
Which
one. It's Arkham
one
City. The second one.
Oh, the second one.
The one with Arkham in the title.
What do you mean Easter eggs coming out? Like they had stuff programmed in or they're pushing
updates? There's a Calendar Man Easter egg somebody found like 3 years after the game came out. It was they found it for the first time the other day.
That's cool.
I can't remember what it was though.
I didn't really enjoy Arkham City as much as I thought I would.
Yeah.
I liked Arkham City more than Arkham Asylum for sure.
I liked Arkham Asylum a bit better.
I like them both equally. I'm not just saying that to be different. I like them both for different reasons. I kind of like the tight environments of the first one, but I also like the openness of the second one. So,
yeah. Those Batman games are my favorite Batman thing because I get the most enemies that look rad per hour of entertainment.
Their Batman is too bulked up for me.
Forget Batman. Look at Commissioner Gordon.
Yeah, they're all too bulked up. They carry it's too much. It crosses the line for me.
I only care about the villains of Batman. So,
is there any more questions, Keir?
Why don't you make the eyes white? And follows up with white eyes like your torchlight just caught dozens of orbs in the dark.
Ooh.
There's some white eyes.
Freaky.
Yeah, people like the eyes.
Like the glowing eyes, eh?
Look at everything behind him, all the pustules. That's disgusting.
Yeah, the light from the eyes will make it easier to see.
He's really just one big acne commercial or something.
Right? Oh,
yeah. I wish that one of those acne companies were like that gum company that just spends way too much money on their commercials that look rad. Of course, both brands are blanking on me, so their commercials didn't do that great of a job. You know those gum, like the gum commercials?
Where the guy's like in this crazy double helix and there's all these little microbots that fly all around him, and in the end it's for gum, and you're like, what is going on? Or he like drives really fast and breaks through the time barrier to find himself shaving in the mirror that morning. Like,
reminds of the more one where they're like stuck in like post-apocalyptic like gladiator chain. Like, they're like running through a wind tunnel and...
This is a gum commercial?
Yeah. I think it's Take Five. That sounds like a gum.
Okay.
The commercials are rad.
Clearly. I've never understood shaving commercials for that same reason. They're always like, fuck, those guys are thrilled to shave.
Yeah, I imagine the shaving companies have taken a hit in the popularity of the beard rises.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Razor sales in Vancouver are probably down like 700%.
And they also got those Dollar Raise Club motherfuckers like biting at their heels. You pay like $1 per razor and they send you 30 or something. Guy's got a pretty good commercial.
They certainly spend a lot of money on gum commercials. I just remember when there was Hubba Bubba ones and the guy's like, there's going to be a chewed out. And then like two guys standing in an old West town.
And they're chewing
at each other. Like, that's it. And they try to blow the biggest bubble. And
that never happened in America's Wild West.
Did you say a chewed out?
Yeah, I said there's going to be a chewed out.
Oh my God. How did I miss
that? We got a question about a hero. Specifically the one with the dog called the Houndmaster. I assume if you lose the hound, you lose the master. I can't remember. They knew at one point.
They are a symbiotic being.
So,
it's like the guy in a Samurai Showdown who has the dog. Like, you can't win the fight just as the dog.
One cannot exist without the other.
Yeah. They're one. They're a peace deal.
They share a health bar. Let's put that.
Yeah. Share a health plan. Kind of. One salary. Crow wants to know, what are you guys focusing on lately in development?
That's tough to answer, only because so much.
It's been all over the place, really.
Done effects in the UI. We've done, you know, finishing up monsters and
town stuff.
Town stuff.
We're not allowed to say.
Secret stuff, more secret barking, things. You know, second pass of affliction stuff.
Yeah, usability.
Yeah, a lot of usability.
The last three things I finished were trinket automatic item class creation, roster size capping, and quest goal display fading. So,
sweet!
Take that, as you will.
That is where the rubber meets the road.
See, you are working hard.
Hot tasks like add these stat buffs, buff asserts, read in the bufflibrary.json.
There's an unusually large amount of chests that pop out kittens right now in the game. Also, we've been working. Chests are in like strong boxes. There's many, many strong boxes littered through every dungeon, and all of them pop out kittens.
Yeah. It's true. I tried to think of the most horrible thing you could find in a curio when you open it, and that was it. I've been knee deep in piggies animating the swine for the Warrens.
So I'm going to start a new question vehicle in honor of the last stream of the year. It's called the Feature Creep Ferris Wheel. Sneaky Pie Brown wants to know, can you choose the breed of the dog?
Not right now.
No. It's a hound. It's of some kind.
It's a hound. He's a master. We're overworked.
You can choose.
It will not be a terrier. It won't be a shih tzu or a mastiff or...
The old stupid answer of you can choose any breed as long as it's the...
As long as it's that one.
The dog will change color once we get color customization.
Yes.
So don't... Yeah.
Don't what?
Again, I was thinking there's possible color to start with that would mess that all up. Like, are there color restrictions with the color grading?
I don't know. To be honest, I haven't really, like, sat down and properly jammed on it.
Like, making something, like, black and white, I could see...
Yeah, that works.
Oh, that works? Okay.
Uh-huh.
Somebody... I can't pronounce her name. Can you talk about some stuff with town? We saw the blacksmith, but what other things can we look forward to?
Yeah, someone could talk about town.
Tyler.
Talk about town, Tyler.
Okay. I'm going to plug one of the underrepresented buildings so far. It's called the Nomad Wagon. You can buy hot trinkets there.
Right.
Your turn, Tyler.
Try and top that.
Yeah, I don't know if I can. Well, town is that's where you recruit heroes, upgrade heroes, purchase new skills for them, train them in camping skills, and then kind of the hook of the game is like that's where you relieve the stress. So that's really the biggest, or I would say the most interesting stuff in terms of you know what makes a Darkest Dungeon is when your heroes come back from the quest and they're all stressed out. It's not just a matter of kind of letting them sit. You have to take them in and give them activities to do, send them to the tavern to drink or gamble or things, and send them to church to pray and things like that. And so you actually drag them into slots, and they do that commits them to the activity. And then while you go on quests with other heroes, then you know these guys are assumed to be doing that. And then when you come back, you kind of get updated on what happened, like. Oh, so-and-so gambled and, you know, worked out or, you know, and this, they lowered stress. But now the downside is, you know, they're addicted to gambling or things like that. So, so you can kind of relieve your stress, but there's also lots of side effects that can happen, both good and bad. And, then we've got a graveyard, which will keep track of your dead heroes because that's kind of a fun, well, and a very classic roguelike thing in the sense of, remembering old Jonas who met his end at the hand of the maggots, you know, that kind of stuff. So what you do is when you get back from the dungeon, you use your resources, not just to upgrade your heroes, but to upgrade town. And when you start out, the town is basically ruined and almost demolished because, you know, that goes in with the story of your estate's been overrun and years have passed or some amount of years have passed. And when you come back, it's kind of like, shells of all the buildings, and then as you start going on successful quests, you bring resources back and upgrade those. And then as you upgrade the buildings, they get kind of more powerful in what they do too. So, you know, as you upgrade the bar, then it relieves more stress, and you can open more slots so that multiple people could be drinking at the same time, things like that.
Question with the town: are the effects of recovery while in these locations variable, like a random number generator?
There's some random elements, but there's kind of guaranteed some amount of guaranteed results. Like, you're not going to get screwed and be like, oh, I sent him gambling and he healed zero stress. But there might be a range. And then also whether or not he becomes a known cheat or wins money or loses money, those things kind of vary.
Cool.
And there are also like, there's different results in every activity, as you might guess. So, you kind of have to play the game to start figuring out like what things can happen. And then another, you know, you guys have probably, some of you that may have like seen some footage, the quirks that your heroes have might that affects things. So like if you're God fearing, like you're only going to pray or flagellate for stress relief. Like you're not going to get anything out of drinking and gambling because your personality is such that your way of reducing stress is different. You know, and likewise if someone's addicted to the booze, then that's kind of what they need to do.
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah, their personalities play out, which is, fun. It makes them different. And then you kind of have to manage, like, okay, I really want to put that one in gambling, but this guy will only do gambling, so maybe I better put this other one in drinking, even though I know that could have a bad side effect. And, it's part of the game.
We have a question if you can name the dog. I would suggest that the generated names for the Houndmaster would have a slash in them and then just have two names.
Or just an and. So-and-so and so-and-so.
Like Pinky and Wiggles?
Just like that.
Well, yeah. We can just pull from the random names. So it could be like whatever crazy old English names you chose.
Yeah, that's interesting.
But the dog's one unit, so.
Yeah.
I never thought about that, actually.
Yeah.
Naming the dog. I never thought about it because I don't have a dog or think about dogs.
Chris is like, people name their dogs? That's so weird.
It's true, we do. That's people that own dogs.
Noxus D wants to know if we've tried The War Is Mine.
No, Brooks, you haven't played that?
No, I haven't. I think I put it on my ever-increasing wish list on Steam. I think I have 60 games or something on there now because I'm like, oh, that looks interesting, and I have no time to play it. It looked really cool, but yeah, I haven't tried it. Has anyone else tried it?
No. I remember the trailer getting a lot of hype. I'm actually surprised to see it out already.
What's that zombie game that it looks like? It came out a while ago. Last Light? Is that right?
Summer of Arcade game.
Is it Last Light?
No, that's the new first person.
No, that's Dying Light.
Dying Light.
No.
I don't know. You know what I'm talking about, though.
The new game. Or no, Metro is Last Light.
Last Light, yeah. Okay, but you know what I'm talking about, though, right?
I'm just gonna turn on Steam.
Yeah, it's like a 2D side.
And you're all in silhouette.
Deadlight from the
Deadlight. That's right.
Thank you.
It looks a lot like Deadlight.
Thank you, Jammers.
Alrighty, here. Let's see what we can do.
I played a bit of that.
You played a bit of what?
Of Deadlight.
Oh, okay. It's not being made by the same company.
It looks like they have enough of their own thing going on to be their own thing. I'm just saying it reminded me of
of that game. Absolutely.
Yeah. I definitely agree. the user review section of the Steam page says overwhelmingly positive.
That's where you want to be.
Just kind of, I didn't know there was like different kind of ratings on the general review.
Yeah, there's like overwhelmingly negative, positive, mixed, overwhelmingly positive. I think those are all five.
Another question: what kind of afflictions can characters get? Can they be cursed with vampirism, lycanthropy?
That's where you turn into a werewolf.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was like, that's
or a were-rat or some.
It's any
rat.
Wearing, right?
It's it's any wearing.
Like once you start wearing out.
Yeah.
I'm wearing out. Wearing out, I'm sweating. So we got
who wants to answer that question?
Well, the afflictions that we deal with are like mostly sort of stress related. So it wouldn't really be an affliction in our game to become a vampire. I mean, A, that would be fucking awesome. So no one would really, I wouldn't be upset about it if it happened to me. And I've been clear about that to my wife, so that's fine. But yeah, usually it's like more like depression and masochism and abusiveness and things like that affect the group dynamic, from a social and kind of like psychological standpoint, as opposed to things like lycanthropy and stuff like that, which are more like kind of curses and stuff. We might add that kind of stuff as quirks maybe, but it's not really what we consider to be an affliction.
Should I give them a quick rundown of what's currently implemented, or yeah, keep sure. that secret?
No. Well, we've talked about it.
So currently implemented, fearful, paranoid, masochistic, abusive, selfish,
wait. Oh, affliction? Okay, yeah. I don't know. We got to leave some mystery, man.
Okay, I'll stop it there. But we're implementing, like, a bunch more, so.
We are?
So?
We're implementing more behaviors. We're not trying to get every possible affliction out of them. I don't know. Right now, our focus is, like, a bit more on the human stuff, is maybe one way of putting it, like, as opposed to, like, wearing out and... Yeah, I don't know. Like, the vampire werewolf stuff's been done to death. It's not totally outside the realm of possibility at some point that there could be a creature that infects you and something happens. But right now we're kind of, like, focusing on the human, like, the human flaws and the human things that are, there's kind of enough dramatic license there, even though you may encounter all these weird creatures that are totally, you know, supernatural. But,
yeah, our game isn't really about, like, how rough it would be to be a vampire adventurer. It's just how rough it would be to be an adventurer, period, in all your sort of flawed humanity.
Because it'd be less stressful if you were a vampire.
Totally it would be. Because you're walking around with three other meat bags, which, so right. you're fine for food.
Yeah. Unless three other of them were werewolves, and then it might be a problem.
Then you're in that movie with the brunette.
Twilight?
No. Where she's fighting them all the time. Like, Underworld. Countless movies. Underworld, yeah.
Yeah. My parents really like the Underworld series.
Alright, I think...
I like the Underworld series mainly for the Kate Beckinsale element.
Kate Beckinsale, that's who it is.
In the leather... Or faux leather, or pleather, or nylon, or
PVC outfit,
PVC, or wetsuits, or whatever it is.
Wetsuits are a pain to get in and out of.
Yes, they are.
Yeah.
That looks pretty good from a painting standpoint, anyway.
Oprah, not really sure. How much emphasis will be for the story and the plot? So far I'm getting that it'll be similar to XCOM, which is much more action oriented, but you get some storytelling in between missions as you make progress.
Yeah, it's a lot like that, I think. We're definitely more of like a sandboxy game in the sense that, like, you're not going to shepherd you from story mission to story mission. You kind of pick them up when you feel like it's time and move the story forward that way. But we want to give you a lot of flexibility in terms of where you can go and where you want to adventure and that kind of thing.
Will characters have the masochist trait magically start wearing BDSM masks?
Yes.
It's going to be the one thing you can equip to your hero.
Yeah.
Change visuals is going to be it. BDSM. We got the sponsorship deal. It's
right.
Yeah, it's good.
Steering clear of all answers.
You don't want to ruin our chances of getting another... BDSM mass sponsorship.
Okay, so I guess all I have to do left in this guy is the dudes, which I won't have time to do today, but
is he pointing?
It's just a shitty rough drawing. He's more meant to be like just running,
turning away and his
fingers are just like left to their own kind of devices, follow through is.
We got a finger count on that hand. Three fingers and a thumb.
No, you just can't see his other one. There it is.
No, four fingers.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it'd be pretty dumb to see that thing and point at it and go, what?
I know, like it needs to be pointed at. Like, no, guys, look over there. That's where I'm looking right now.
Is anybody else seeing this?
Yeah.
Behold, what is yonder creature?
I don't even know if that thing can move or even get through the hole that's in front of it. Like,
well, it'd like change and jam itself through and keep reconfiguring and changing. It's like the thing, right?
And how do you know it doesn't have those freaky alien jaws that can extend it? You're like, oh, big creature can't fit through the hole, and then, yeah. And it's like, you're gone, right? Just like that. I really hate looking at this thing.
Really? I think it looks rad.
I have a problem with like see all those pustules, like that. Like some people are mouth people, like mouths freak them out. Some people feet freak them out.
Do you pustules freak you out?
Well, like yeah, all the collection of the.
Oh shit! Look at that monster.
Try animating them, Tyler. You can't stop looking at them. I have to like take these horrible creatures and cut them up in Photoshop and
carefully move. Cut them up.
Yeah, carefully, yes. Like excise each pustule and.
Yeah. Like the swine wretch. I spent a whole day animating this swine wretch, and I just could not get him out of my. It was just imprinted on my brain after that.
That's good though.
Horrible, horrible little thing.
Question from Miss and Mr. B. In what century will the game take place?
It kind of takes place like outside of time, really.
It's a little bit anachronistic.
Yeah, like it's sort of like if the Dark Ages had run a couple hundred years too long, kind of Twilight Zone-y. It just happens like in a back eddy in time almost. That's not to say that we're gonna have like the Master Chief is gonna fucking roll up. You know,
we didn't get that stretch goal.
No, we didn't get the Master Chief stretch goal. But yeah, it's not like 1674. Here we are. It's just yeah, it's kind of like this backwater place that's outside of all of that measurement.
Rio Bucks has the question everybody wants to know the answer to. Will the monster be vibrating in the cutscene?
Absolutely. That looks pretty good. That's pretty readable, right? From back here?
What? So somebody, like, balancing their phone on their feet?
What?
Well, you zoomed it out really far. I'm like...
Yeah, because I want to make sure that it, like, it's clear what the hell is going on.
I get that, yeah. It's just, I'm just picturing the test case where somebody's on a bus at the front of the bus looking at this trailer and you're like, oh, shit, what's that?
Oh, right.
I would say the majority of the heroes are probably definitely later. It's like things like the Hellion that kind of...
The Crusader, too, is a bit on the back end of this time spectrum, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, but his armor is like... I mean, that could be like 1300s, whereas the Hellion... But it all fits. It's kind of like these people are in different regions, too, so...
You know, the Highwayman would be the most futuristic, because he's got a flintlock pistol, and that wasn't...
That was like, what, 1600s, right?
That's post-Renaissance anyway, so it's...
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I just imagine it like, yeah, like the Dark Ages went too long. We never had the Renaissance, but that didn't stop some sort of, like, trickle-down technological innovation. But, yeah.
It's like Rifts or Torg.
But not at all. So yeah, then the subtle thing I want to get across, and hopefully you guys see this, is like this makes our sort of stress symbol, in with the red.
Oh.
Well, I think the subtleness of that just went out the window.
Well, I know, but this is for people watching. But yeah, so like you can watch for that motif; it'll show up a lot.
Yeah, we can start a Tumblr blog about all the places where you can find the stress.
That would be rad.
Person with the best Tumblr. Chaos Bagel asks, do you guys plan on moving this to Android or iOS?
Yes.
I think moving would probably not be the appropriate word.
Yeah, I mean, well, that's all right. Yeah, I mean, at some point, it would be cool to explore those devices, and it's on our radar, but it's down the line. Like, it wouldn't be at full release. Let's put it that way. It would be after that.
Yeah. It'd be also nice to get it as many places as we can get it, that's for sure.
And what we haven't decided is whether it would be, like, the same experience or something similar using the same kind of systems but different. I don't know. That depends. But, I mean, I think it would be rad to play it on an iPad or those other tablets that...
That you don't unstock in.
That aren't iPads.
And also the great thing about mobile is that the longer you wait each year, the more powerful every device gets. So it's kind of like...
Yeah.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah, those markets are interesting because it I mean, I think they'll be there, but it's just crazy that like what's working today might be totally different in a year. So, you know, we love thinking about all the ways, I don't know, like to, there's so much Darkest Dungeon stuff we want to do. It's just really bottom line. But, you know, you guys hear us say it all the time. We're just trying to focus on what's ahead of us. I feel like a freaking football player, like when they have their press conferences. It's
like a hockey player.
How do you feel about Kula? Well, right now we're preparing for Miami, and you know that's really our focus right now. And
they're a tough team, a lot of good players. You know, we just got to put in the hours.
Yeah, you know, we can't look past any opponent right now, and
every
know,
win counts.
This is on the horizon.
Yeah, PCs definitely are kind of main focus.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, when we've been making the game, we've thought of it from a perspective of, like, what do PC gamers like? Because we're PC gamers and we love to play. As opposed to going, you know, how can we make a game that'll fit on everything? And I think that's been kind of fun because it allows you to be more authentic to the platform. And then it's easy enough. Well, not easy, but it's a better exercise to then go, okay, awesome. Now, you know, if we were to put this on iPad, you know, what would it be like? Oh, and if it ends up being the same thing, then rad, you know. But if we're like, oh, you know what we could do on iPad that's totally different, then that's good too. So
we can wake people up with a different monster each day.
What's that?
I said we can wake people up with a different monster each day.
Oh, did you tell people about your wakey-wakey? Oh, no, it's too late.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like it's dead now, but there's this great app called Wakey.
It's dead now already? What was that, like an hour and a half?
I got calls from robots this week. Actually, today I got a call from a human. But you basically set it up and say, hey, I want to wake up at this time, and then some random person phones you. So, yeah, if you want the chance to wake me up.
Before you go.
Install Wakey and... try it out around 7:30 a.m. on Pacific Standard Time.
What if I try it around at like 4:30 a.m.?
Well, then you're not going to wake me up. You'll wake somebody who's waking up at 4. I get a lot of Texans and English people, and they all know about Darkest Dungeon now. So, doing my part.
You're finding the most obscure way to promote our game.
Like, that's grassroots, man. Sign up for Wakey Wakey. Wait for someone to call you. You can tell one person a day.
But man, oh man, if that person tells a person.
Yeah, that's street team.
Look out.
Let me answer a couple of these before we go.
Yeah, we got to head over here pretty soon.
No microtransactions. This is a buy it, own it, play it. Like, yes, we might do paid DLC at some point maybe, but it's not going to be horse armor. It's going to be legit stuff. No, this is like the classic dig on it or bygone age of buy the game and
then play it as much as you
want. And also it's going to be hard and mean, and we don't want to make it hard and mean and then go for $9.99, you can make it easier. So we won't be doing that.
Also Tyler doesn't believe in microtransactions. He only deals in macro transactions.
He'll only lend you $10,000, but he won't buy you coffee.
No, it's just you got to design differently, and this game's meant to be punishing, and I think it's the wrong message to be punishing and then have a handout for dialing down the difficulty through, like, whatever.
Is there any stuff we have cut, let's just say, from early access that we're going to put later in the game?
We move stuff around, especially right now, because we're going, okay, we got this much time left, and certain things we thought maybe were super important, then other things pop up and we realize, you know, we can only pick one. So we've kind of got these lists that are pretty fluid that everybody looks at, and then we talk and haggle, and then you know, if an idea is good and we know we want to do it, then we find a spot to put it. It's just kind of like now, later, or, you know, future. And so those things move around a bit.
I'm just guessing that Robux wants an example of what specific thing.
Sorry. Okay. Yeah, let me...
I think that'd be cool.
Okay, I'll just talk about this. I don't know for sure, but there's this kind of what we're calling a fear and slayer mechanic, which is kind of like, okay, if you fight a lot of ghouls and they freak you out, like that guy might actually become really afraid specifically of ghouls. It's always been something we wanted to do, etc. But it doesn't look like it's going to get in for start of early access, even though we designed it, etc. So that's been kind of moved to like during early access. That would make sense to put in.
Apparently, Steam updated the early access rules guidelines for developers. So it's a good thing we had the stream, because now we have the link. I'll send it.
I did see that today. I think the big thing that they did is they said you can't really offer it elsewhere earlier than Steam. So I think, I'm not a lawyer, I haven't read it in detail, but I think what they're trying to say is like it affects Kickstarter games, because they're kind of saying you can't give it to all your backers first and then later bring it to Steam, but I'm not positive. So we'll see. That might not constitute the same as sales, so we got to look into that more. But cool. I'll tell you one thing is you don't want to anger Steam.
Yeah.
Yeah. As we learned from the news events of a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
you don't mess with Gabe.
All right, so should we call it?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, here's the last
one. One parting shot before you close it, Chris.
Mm-hmm.
Is just, hey, everybody, like, go to the forum, all that. Like, this doesn't mean we're done interacting for the year. It's just kind of like, you know, like I'm sure Chris will say a bit more, but don't be strangers. The forum, the community, darkestdungeon.com is still rad. So,
yeah. Hang on. We got there. Emails, we have Twitters, we have
Facebook.
There will be news coming.
Yeah, and we have, we've got some news trickling out in the next couple of weeks, as well as a backer update coming, so we're definitely not done talking. We just want to avoid the sort of midweek hiccup and really drill down heading into the holidays, so that's really all that's about, and we'll be back, I'm sure, in the new year, probably with more gameplay and stuff.
Yeah.
But until then, thank you so much for watching, and hit us up on the forums.
Thanks,
happy
everyone.
Happy New Year, everybody.
Yeah, happy New Year.